Welcome students, we are going to cover international compensation today, which is one of the topics in your cross-cultural management subject. Let us start with the introduction of international compensation. What do we understand by international compensation? What are its objectives? So, whenever an expatriate leaves the home country and goes to an international assignment, there he needs to be compensated according to the rules, regulations and policies of that country. Now, which may differ from country to country, which may not remain exactly the same. The components might differ, the ways of giving might differ, the policies of compensation can be different, the laws and rules and regulations acting upon it might be different. So with this respect, it becomes very important for us to understand the idea behind international compensation, to study why it is important and what components does it constitute of, and what are the differences in various countries as regards payments to its employees when it comes to expatriates' payments. These are all the topics which we are going to cover in the further presentation. Objectives, components, approaches, the factors influencing compensation, and theories of compensation. This is going to be our presentation plan. What are the objectives of global compensation? That is, what do we actually aim to achieve when we are talking of global compensation? The first objective is improve organizational performance. That is, overall we want that if an employee is compensated well, then the idea of getting the best performance can be achieved. Recruit and retain competent employees. We can only attract good and talented employees if the compensation policies are well made and they are actually very lucrative for the employees who are going in for international assignments. In fact, this compensation forms the first motivation factor for these employees who leave their home country and join a host country for international assignments or overseas jobs. So it's very helpful in recruiting such people and retaining them for a longer duration for an overseas assignment. Consistency and equity in pay. Compensation management is required because it is very important that the payments which are done in the organization are justifiable. That is, each and every employee should have a feeling of fairness and justice in their mind. That is, there is consistency and equity in the payments to the employees. There is employee mobility in a cost-effective manner. You're going to have employees for you're going to prepare them for overseas assignment, which is going to be a cost-effective manner if you frame the compensation policy in such a way. Because the idea is to take the consent from the employee to move from one place to another. So, the mobility is only possible when you give them an attractive package, and which can be done in a most effective way by means of compensation management. There is financial protection to employee. Compensation management also aims at giving financial protection to the employees in a way that social security benefits are being provided, and the employees feel more job secure, there is feeling of security in them, and that is how which is covered under compensation management. Organization ability to pay, that is what how an organization can pay to its employees in a way looking into its scope. So, compensation management can be framed according to the organization's ability. There is a business cycle. So, at every stage of a business cycle, the payment capacity of the organization differs. And so, accordingly, the compensation management can deal with it at every stage, how to bring about improvement in the packages with a change in the business cycle. Competitive and comparable. The idea behind compensation management, or the basic goal which can be achieved, is whether the payments are competitive or they are at par with the competitors in the market, and they should be comparable so that the employees would stay in that organization for a longer duration. Then we have benefit management, how these employees can be compensated in a way that more and more benefits are given to them, it reaches them, the share of profits reaches them. So that can be taken care of by compensation, by an effective compensation management. So these are all objectives of global compensation which are to be achieved by any organization, whether in one country or another. The idea, the aim, the objective remains the same. So, what is compensation? Compensation is the amount of remuneration paid to an employee by the employer in return to the employee's services to the company. Compensation is extrinsic reward for an employee. Extrinsic rewards include praise from superior, salary, employee benefits, career progression, etc. So when we talk about this, there is generally, whenever a person enters into a job, there is a psychological contract. That is, if he is going to give his services, then in return he would get some form of remuneration or compensation which is expected by him. So this type of psychological contract generally goes on with compensation. And it is basically an extrinsic reward for an employee in the form of, you know, various benefits, growth in the career. So almost all employees accept jobs in MNCs, take up assignments in various other countries, and take up the risk, bear inconveniences and discomforts in foreign assignments, mostly based on the compensation package. Like I have already specified, that compensation package is the first factor which motivates an employee to move for foreign assignments. Then what are the principles of compensation which are to be followed while preparation of any form of compensation policy? First is be legal. You need to actually adhere to the laws and rules, regulations of that particular country, and then keeping all the laws in mind, then you can frame the compensation policy. Be adequate, giving sufficient salary to the employees as per their expectations, and sometimes maybe going ahead of the expectations. Be motivating. The compensation should be such that is motivating for the employees, that is the employees would feel motivated and would feel very much they should have that inner drive to work well, to perform well in the organization. So it should act as a motivating factor for them. Be equitable. In a way, whenever an employee compares his salary to the other comparable other, so in that situation he should have that feeling of justice and fairness in his mind, that why the other person is getting more or less as compared to his salary. So that that feeling of equity should be there. Be cost benefit effective. The compensation policy should be framed in such a way that is, there should be a balance between cost and benefits. Provide security, that is, it should give a feeling of a sense of security amongst the employees, in a way giving a good protection to meet out the basic requirements of the employees and maybe taking care of his future requirements. Then what approaches are there in various countries? Let us discuss this. In USA, compensation package includes base salary, bonus, long-term incentives and other benefits and perks. The base salary is a small part of the total package. In Europe, if we compare it with Europe, paid less compensation than that of American executives, but benefits and employee perks are much better in Europe than America. So the more emphasis is on benefits when we talk about European payment systems. In Japan, the compensation levels of CEOs of large companies are just one third of those of American CEOs. Japanese compensation is based on seniority of employees. So basically in Japan, you would see that the employees are compensated based on their seniority, for how long they have worked in an organization. So these are the approaches which are being followed in various countries. There are two issues in compensation which should be discussed. The first one, pay executives in different countries according to the standards in each country or equalize pay on a global basis. And secondly, what should be the method of payment? So whenever an employee goes on for an overseas assignment, this issue has to be dealt in with. That is, whether he has to be paid according to the other country's standards or there should be an equalization of pay, and all the countries should be kept at par. And what should be the method of payment, how it should be paid. So we can have a look at these types of companies and the payments, which can be helpful in solving our two questions which we had. The first is the type of company and the how of the payment should be done. So whenever a company is having an ethnocentric approach, which means that the parent country always tries to impose its own culture on the subsidiary company which is being established on in a host country. So there the ethnocentric approach is being followed. Now here in such an organization, the payments, the question is how much home country expatriate should be paid. So you have to always see that how these people are to be compensated, because whenever you are trying to impose your culture on the host country, whether it should follow the pattern of payments in a similar way or there should be some other way of payments. Second is polycentric approach. So in case the company is following an polycentric approach, which means that the host country is free in a way to adapt its own country's culture into the organization, and with very less interference from the parent company which is set up in foreign country. So pay can and should be country specific. Here generally it is believed that when you are hiring people from the host country, or we are actually hiring HCNs, that is host country nationals, so in this particular situation the pay can be country specific. The third approach which we follow is geocentric or transnational approach, which means that the country wherein the subsidiary is being set up, there the subsidiary tries to have employees based on its merits, that is how they are, what qualification do they have, and irrespective of any nationality they hire employees. So they may have to pay its international cadre of managers the same. So basically the question might arise whether you are going to pay them at par with the country from where they are coming in, or according to the local conditions, but then that has to be decided. So it's another compensation issue. Now what are the employee expectations and international organizations' compensation policy? What is the linkage and what are the employee expectations? Financial protection in terms of benefits, social security and cost of living in the foreign location. Foreign assignments offer opportunities for advancement through income and savings. Issues such as housing, education of children and recreation are addressed. Now generally the expectation of the employees do not coincide with the interest of the organization. So in that situation they have to be motivated, and so that there can be a common alignment of goals in between the organization and expectation of employees. And the package could be built upon in such a way that alignment is created. So again, these are expectations of an expatriate. He would go in for looking for financial protection. Then they can be looking for his own growth in the form of advancement through income or promotions or good opportunities. And certain other issues such as providing of provision of good house, education for his children, and all these recreation issues and other issues are being addressed. So that can be the components of compensation policy then. Now, what are the complexities of global compensation? Whenever you are trying to determine what should be the compensation for an expatriate, these complex issues are generally which comes in the way of framing of this policy. So the first is exchange rate fluctuations. Whenever you think of paying an employee, you set up this package, but you know, the rates might go up and down as per the market conditions, as per the economic conditions of that country. So sometimes that employee may be compensated a little bit higher than required, or maybe compensated a little bit lesser as compared to the previous one. So those are the impacts of the fluctuation rates. Then we have varying tax rates. Now again, if an expatriate is moving from his country and is joining another place, then the issue is like whether he is required to pay tax at his home country and then again pay the taxes at the local local place where he is working. So what these taxation issues are also very important to be dealt with. Then we have varying inflation rates. Obviously there is continuous change in inflation rates, so the cost of living becomes expensive. And such situations, the compensation should take care of such issues, and accordingly the policy should be framed. Then changing the local conditions, say if there are certain political changes or changes in the market situation or the consumer tastes have changed. So accordingly there will be an impact on the business, and which might have a, you know, in this situation the compensation can become somewhat more expensive, and that might add to the cost of the organization. Then we have country perspectives. That is the point of view of that country where the person is working, how it should be paid. Consistency and equity, that we already discussed, that one thing which is very difficult to maintain is the feeling of justice and equity in the minds of employees who are working there. Then employee expectations, certainly that has to be taken care of by framing of compensation, so which is again a complex issue. Varying cost of living, again it relates with the inflation rate, so it might differ, say if a person is moving from one zone to another, so the two zones might differ. For example, in US a person is moving from say west zone to east zone, so that becomes a more costlier issue. So again he has to be compensated accordingly. So varying requirements for facilities, the employee may ask for certain more facilities, maybe say a facility of a cab or maybe a driver, so it might change. So again that makes the compensation management a more complex issue to be dealt with. So what are the factors that affect global compensation? Now when we talk about these factors, you can look here. Whenever a compensation package is being set up, there are certain factors which act upon it, which actually influence the compensation package. And we can see here, firstly the internal environment, that is MNC's internal environment and external environment. So the factors which are more affecting internally, which have an influence on compensation package, firstly we have goal orientation and compensation objectives. So what is the goal orientation? Whether an organization is a profit-making organization or it is philanthropic nature. So depending on the objective and goal of the organization, the compensation package might differ. A profit-making organization might have higher packages as compared to the non-profit making organizations. So that might have an impact on compensation packages. Then competitive strategy. When we talk about competitive strategy, say for instance, a company has a competitive strategy of innovation. Now, with innovation, obviously the company would require to hire very specialist employees, the employees which are very much capable, skilled and well averse with the technology. So here the payments would be very high for such employees because the supply of such employees would be very less in the market. So accordingly, the payments have to be kept very high. Then we have organization culture. That is, what has been the culture of the organization as regards its compensation systems. Then we have human resource structure. How many lines of hierarchy or authorities do we have? That also has an impact on the compensation package. Employee-employer relations. How far the employees are capable of negotiations in the organization. Do they have any say in creation of compensation packages? Then a subsidiary role. Subsidiary role is whether the subsidiary is contributing a big portion of profits in the headquarters. That also has an impact on compensation, or whether it's of a very small in nature, wherein the headquarters is already well-established business and subsidiary may be a very small one. So here the compensation packages might differ. The level of technology is at what a subsidiary which is set up or which is at a preliminary stage and having basic technology wherein you require less skilled people to work on it would have a mediocre compensation package. But wherein you have a high intensive technology wherein you require specialists, in such a situation the compensation package would be very different, would be higher. So these are all the internal factors which have an impact on the compensation package. Other than these, we have the external environment factors, like say the first one is parent country. What is the role of parent country, or how strong is its establishment? What is the level of interference of parent country in the subsidiary's establishment? So all such things will have an impact on the package. Labor market characteristics. Whether we can look for supply and demand of employees wherein there is very restricted supply of skilled employees in such situation. If we have or if we hire such employees, then the compensation package would be very high. Then what are the local conditions, the market rates, home and host country government rules, then industry type, what industry it belongs to. There may be, certain industry are very, highly compensated employees. For instance, if you talk about petroleum industry or with all this power industry, the people are compensated in a high manner as compared to other industries. Then lastly, what are the competitor strategies? That is, what strategy is being followed by the competitor, and accordingly, the package is being framed out. So we have discussed these internal factors. Again, these are the external factors. Now, what are the components of global compensation package? There are four heads under it when we talk about compensation package. The first is base salary, incentive pay, allowances, taxes, and retirement benefits. Now let us discuss each one of them separately. The first one, we have base salary and incentive pay. So what is base salary? It is a fixed amount of money paid to an employee by an employer in return for work performed, and base salary does not include benefits, bonus, or any other potential compensation from an employer. The base salary is either paid in the expatriate's home or parent country currency, or in the currency of expatriate's host country. So that is a base salary. The second is incentives or variable pays. Now when we talk about incentives or variable pay, they are generally based on performance of the employees. So a growing number of MNCs have dropped the ongoing premium for overseas assignment and replaces it with a one-time lump sum premium. So this premium might be, you know, in a way performance based. So even in domestic MNCs, they are preferring one-time premiums to periodic salaries. So it varies as per the performance of the employees, and the more is the better is the performance, the more incentives and variable pays are being added with the compensation package of the employees. Then we have use of long-term benefits. These long-term benefits can be in the form of employee stock option plans, what we call as ESOPs, and which are going to fetch or yield profits to the employees for a longer duration. And this is plan established by a company wherein a certain number of shares are reserved for purchase and issuance to key employees, and such shares usually vest over a certain period to serve as an incentive for employees to build long-term value for the company. Next we have allowances, which are a very good component of the international compensation. Let us see one by one, cost of living allowance. Now when we talk about cost of living allowance or COLA, it is a component which is being paid to the expatriates depending on the place where they are living, and depending upon that place cost of living. So for example, in USA, if a person is working was working in the West Zone, maybe in California, then he would get a very high amount of COLA as compared to if he used to work in New Jersey, which is the eastern part of the US. So there the COLA amount would be lesser because the cost of living is higher in California. So in this situation, the COLA might differ because of the cost of living of that place. Then we have housing allowance. This is the allowance which is payment is made to the expatriate with a view to ensure that he can maintain their home country living standard in the host country. Alternatively, an organization may provide housing facilities on a mandatory or optional basis. Also, support services may be provided to the expatriate, for example, by helping sell or rent the expatriate's house in the home country. So this is housing allowance. Home leave allowance is the payment is made to the expatriate with a view to facilitating their visit back to the home country once or twice a year. Home leaves enables the expatriate to renew business, family and social ties, and thus avoid adjustment problems subsequent to repatriation. Then we have relocation allowance, the payment made with a view to enable the relocation of expatriate to the assignment location includes moving, shipping, storage costs, subsidies for purchase of appliances, and possibly an automobile. So that is the relocation allowance which is being given to the expatriate. Then we have education allowance. Payment made with a view to support the education of expatriate's children. That is tuition fee, maybe language class, teaching the child language of that particular company, that country. School enrollment fees, book supplies, transportation to education establishment, room and boarding, school uniforms, etc. Problems regarding the level of education required and adequacy of school in the host country and transportation to other localities may pose significant problems for organizations. There can be miscellaneous allowances, like depending on the level of seniority of the expatriate, payments to him for club memberships, sport associations, maintenance of household staff may be rendered. In addition, the organization may render financial assistance to the spouse for her loss of income as a result of the transfer of the expatriate. Benefits can be in the form of support rendered to an expatriate in addition to the allowance, and these can be social security benefits, may be given at the home country rate or host country, paid vacations for expatriate and family, rest and rehabilitation leave especially for expatriates based on hardship assignment locations, basically where it's very difficult to survive and difficult places as regards political disturbance or maybe which the countries which are not at peace. Emergency cases, in case of severe illness or death, certain benefits are being provided for in the compensation. Now, when we talk of, this is another hardship premium, another form of benefit. And this is perceived as an inducement in the form of a salary premium to accept an overseas assignment. Generally, salary premiums vary from 5 to 40% of the basic salary, and determining the appropriate level of payment can be difficult. So, hardship premium is generally given in when the assignment is given at a place which is politically disturbed or where the employee might have to struggle a lot as regards fulfilling his basic requirements. So that would be of more hardship, and so this premium is provided. So actual hardship, tax consequences and length of assignment, all these are the factors which actually formulates this hardship premium. The next issue or next component is taxation. So there are certain problems, issues and challenges as regards taxation, because first thing is dual tax cost. So expatriates paying taxes in both the countries, it forms a big issue. Need to consider personal and corporate taxes in addition to income tax. And another issue is modifying compensation package to provide the most tax effective appropriate rewards within the overall compensation framework. Then next is retirement benefits, which can be in the form of gratuity. Gratuity is defined as benefit plan and is one of the many retirement benefits offered by the employer to the employee upon leaving his job. An employee may leave his job for various reasons, such as retirement, superannuation, for a better job elsewhere, or being retrenched, or by way of voluntary retirement. So it's generally a lump sum amount, and which is based on the length of service of that particular employee in that company. Then we have pension. When we talk about pension, it is a contract for a fixed sum to be paid regularly to a person, typically following retirement from service. Other forms of retirement benefits, we have social security measures. So it's a comprehensive approach designed to prevent deprivation, assure the individual of basic minimum income for himself and his dependents, and to protect the individual from any uncertainties. Certain laws are there. These laws are effective in India, and this we have the Employees Provident Fund Act, the Employees State Insurance Act, Workmen's Compensation Act, the Maternity Benefit Act, the Payment of Gratuity Act. These are certain acts which actually governs all such issues and regulates them. Now, there are certain theories of compensation which have been built upon. When we talk about theories, they are the thought processes, the mindsets of people, how they have, what they feel about compensation, philosophy and policies. So the first is, which is most popular, is contingency theory, wherein the expatriate's compensation should be based on particular situation prevailing in a host country. The compensation philosophy in every organization is normally decentralized and allows units to localize the compensation structure. So it believes in situation and contingency and should not be made par in all situations. So compensation policy can be flexible and accordingly it can be framed out. Then we have the resource-based theory, wherein the human resource is considered to be the greatest asset of an MNC, and it is by it you are going to achieve competitive advantage. So in such a situation, the salary has to be paid well to such employees because it becomes a motivating factor. And the organizations follow this theory, they remain market sensitive and are constantly reviewing compensation to retain their position in the hiring and retaining the talents. Then we have the agency theory. This theory focuses on the divergent interests and goals of organization stakeholders and the way that employees' compensation can be used to align these interests and goals. According to this theory, there exists a principal agency relationship between the MNC's headquarters and its subsidiaries for expatriate compensation. And lastly, we have equity theory, which suggests that there should be a fair balance between an expatriate's contribution to an MNC and what he receives as compensation. The equity principle is sought to be compromised with a new approach to compensation, person-based rather than job-centric approach. So, this theory has been there for long and it is still being followed and practiced and are being applied in compensation policies. So they are talking of a new approach to compensation that is person-based, that is what are the qualifications, knowledge, experience of that person rather than just the job position. So let us have a look, a final look at what are the various components and the way of remunerating employees in various countries, wherein you can see we have taken America, Japan, Russia and Middle East. So the orientation firstly in all these countries can be seen very well. Let us first talk about American form of compensation. Orientation is performance based. Components generally have basic salary, variable bonus, long-term incentives, compulsory benefit contributions, voluntary benefit contribution. Linked with performance, there is excellent linkage, basis of increase, annual merit increase, and influencing cultural variables, that is achievement orientation, that is material possession. Then in Japan, it is seniority based. Components are monthly wage, basic allowance, overtime, variable bonus. There is a moderate linkage with performance because more of it is on seniority basis. Basis of increase, seniority, age, performance ratings to some extent, spring wage negotiation. So how do employees negotiate for on wages? And the influencing cultural variables which do have an influence on formation of the compensation policy or package is hierarchy, and they have given one behavioral aspect, that is patience. Then in Russia, orientation is job level based. What is the position at which the person is working? The components are basic salary, fixed bonus, non-monetary benefits. There is a very poor linkage with performance because seniority of the job is generally considered, and the cultural variables are material possessions, which is more emphasized. And lastly, we have Middle East compensation, way of compensation. Orientation is nationality, group and job level. Components are basic salary, variable bonus, compulsory benefit contributions, voluntary benefit contributions. Now you can see very well all these components are there, and somewhat there is similarity in some of the components. Middle East has the very moderate linkage with performance. The basis of increase is job level, and the cultural variables are material possessions, status, seniority. So this is all about international compensation and various components. So we have discussed almost all the points as per our lecture plan.